Hi there. I'm Matt with K15T, and let's talk about Confluence Automation. Have you ever found yourself sort of bogged down by really repetitive tasks, like creating meeting notes sort of over and over again? Well, in this video, we're going to dive into automation in Confluence Cloud, and stick around because you are going to learn how to automate your workflow and make everybody's lives a lot easier. So first off, what is Confluence Automation? So Confluence Automation is like having a little robot that you've like set up to do a certain task for you, maybe repetitively, over and over again, do this exact same thing for me, and then you just set that robot off to work, and it's great. Your team is over here doing teamwork stuff, and that robot's like, beep, morp, meep, map, doing the same thing over and over again, so that the rest of your team just doesn't have to. That sounds all well and good, but I'm not sure about you, but I'm not a robot programmer. In fact, I'm not a coder at all, so the thought of automating things in Confluence sounds very complex. The good news is you don't have to write code to create an automation. You will have to write a few things maybe specifically in a certain syntax. It's just a way of formatting the instructions so that Confluence understands what it is you're trying to do. So if you have mastered a language, like English, for example, you will be able to do this as well. It just takes a little bit of practice or copying and pasting things from websites. Side note, automation is only available in Confluence Premium and Enterprise instances, so if you're using Confluence Standard, we would recommend you check out automation apps on the Atlassian Marketplace, Script Runner being one of those. So you want to automate something, but what are some things that you might actually automate? Well, it doesn't make sense to build an automation just to do something that's going to be done a handful of times or even one time. Instead, Confluence Automation is really great for those super repetitive tasks that your team is doing in a pattern already. Confluence Automation is great for time-based tasks, like maybe something that needs to happen weekly or daily. It's great at action-based tasks, like when a label is added to a page. Or sometimes it's great for those tasks that you know might need to be just sort of triggered manually or off the cuff. Like, hey, now I want to throw this page through our approval process. That is exactly the kind of stuff you should automate. Like for example, a meeting page for a recurring meeting is automatically created every week. Maybe email reminders are sent weekly or monthly about pages that could potentially be outdated. Maybe every 3 months, all pages with a certain label are archived or deleted. Or maybe when a page is approved by a team member, they can launch an automation that adds labels and changes the status of the page so the team knows it's ready to go. Another side note, this video is not an end-to-end tutorial on how to create automation in Confluence. That would be a whole series of videos. If you're interested, actually let us know in the comments below. Instead, we are talking about the best practices you can use to make the very best automation rules possible. So the first thing you need to do is make sure you actually have the ability to create an automation, which means you need to be a space or site admin. Now you might not think about yourself as a space admin, but if you see the space settings button in your space, you're there. You're ready. You've got the keys. It's time to drive. And by that, I mean take those keys, put them in your pocket, because it's not time to start building stuff in Confluence. It's time to work with your team to figure out what it is you want to build in the first place. So let's say the team is sick of manually creating a weekly meeting page. They have a template for it, but it's still just like click, 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 tickety tick, tick, click, click, click. They're sick of it. So the best way to get that from the team and figure out what to automate and how is by creating a when-then statement. Now maybe you're like, hey, you said we weren't coding. It's not coding, I promise. Really, all when-then statement is a way of formatting what it is people want you to automate so that everybody on the team understands it. So in this case, our when-then statement might be something like, when it's Wednesday at 9 a.m., then create a page with this name and let the team know in this Slack channel. These types of statements are great because everybody can read it, they can understand what needs to happen, and when you go to build your automation, you can pull out all the little logical bits from that sentence and turn it into an automation. Some other things to keep in mind are to keep your automation rules as simple as possible. Sometimes an automation does require a very complex when this and these conditions are met, then do this, this, and this, but always look at your automation and think, do I need this extra step or could I simplify it? Or perhaps it could actually be broken into two different automations to ensure that it's as simple as possible while still accomplishing what you're looking to do. This is also helpful because you want to make sure your automations are scalable. Sure, it works with 3 people on the team, but what about when there's 30 people on the team? Yeah, this works for our team, but what if every team in the company used this automation? Would that work? These are the things you got to keep in mind. And when we're talking about the full organization, sharing really is caring here. If you come up with an automation or the idea for an automation that you think will help another team, let them know. And then finally, make sure you communicate with the team or teams that will be affected by the automation. Don't just go write that when-then statement by yourself and assume that it's going to solve their problems. Instead, communicate with them, show them what you're thinking, get their feedback, and then once your automation is built, run it by them. Make sure they know, hey, this is turned on. This is ready. Does this do what you want it to do? Communication is super important when we're enabling all these little Confluence robots to do really cool things. Got your keys? Let's automate something. So the first thing to know is when you're building an automation in Confluence, you're creating an automation rule. So remember that. To get started creating a new automation rule, there is a collection of templates which are great for understanding sort of how to build an automation rule and also to get you going a little bit faster. There's also intelligence on the way which will actually build templates for you. Super cool. For our example, we are going to go into the rule builder and build a brand new automation rule from scratch. The star of the show here is this area on the left which summarizes everything about this rule. And the first thing we want to do is transform our when-then statement into a logical chain of components that do really cool things in Confluence. The first thing we want to do is pull the when part of our statement out and add a trigger component here in Confluence. A trigger is merely the thing that gets the automation going, and there's a few things you can use to trigger that automation into action. You could trigger with some kind of event in Confluence, like someone creates a page or moves it, or a username is mentioned, or a label is added to a page. You could trigger at a specific date or time. You could let someone trigger something manually using a button at the top of the page. You can even trigger a Confluence automation from an app outside of Confluence, using something called a webhook, which is basically a way for two apps to tell each other, hey, could you do a thing for me? You want to make sure your trigger is as specific as possible. So in this case, we will create a new page on a specific date and time. Adding a trigger that is too vague, like doing something anytime any page is created, could end up having a whole bunch of automations running in your space that maybe just confuse people more than help them. Now we can jump into the then part of our when-then statement, and it's important to know that the items that we add to the component chain will happen in the order that we add them. So if there's any sort of like, this needs to happen before that, let's just make sure that we add them appropriately. In those instances where you've added a very vague trigger or even a specific one, you might want to add some conditions to make sure that you're honing in on exactly what you want the automation to do. And you have a few different options here. On the basic end of things, you could see if a certain user or group of users kicked off this automation or didn't kick it off. You could also write a CQL clause to pull out some bits of things in Confluence to see if those two things compare to each other. You can actually write regular expressions using smart values, those are variables that you've made, to really do some complex comparisons. The good news is that writing CQL statements and doing these advanced comparisons are not writing code, it's more just figuring out how to write normal things in a way that your automation will understand. And by the way, you can even add additional conditions. So you could say, if this thing happens, then do this. If not, do this. It's pretty powerful. Kind of like conditions, there's another tool you can use in the then part of your when-then statement. Branches really help you take actions on specific items, like for each task that is not completed, notify everyone on the team who those tasks are assigned to, or for every page that is deleted, notify the person who created the page that it was deleted. Branches are a great way of automatically traversing through a space to see what has happened or what needs to happen, and maybe do something like trigger notifications. One thing to keep in mind is there is a limit on the number of pages, tasks, etc. that you can run through with a branch. Those limits are always changing, so check them out. Just keep that in mind if you have 60,000 tasks that you want to run through to see if they're open or not, you're probably going to need to run multiple automation rules to catch all of them. The final thing we want to add to the rule chain is the action. That's the then of the when then. when this happens and these conditions are met or this branch runs, then do this action. There are a lot of actions you can take here. Some of them are really basic actions you can do right in Confluence. Some of them allow you to take actions in your third-party tools like Slack or Teams. And you can even use web requests to send a really advanced action to a tool way outside of Confluence. For this example, I'm going to use the publish new page action. And there are a lot of best practices for all of the actions, but let's talk about a few of them for this specific one. First off, it's best to publish in the same space that the automation rule lives in. Otherwise, you're going to have automation rules creating pages in all sorts of different spaces, and people will have trouble figuring out the origins of the pages that are automatically appearing. It's also best in most cases to pick a parent page where the page will be published under. Otherwise, the content tree is just going to be filled up with pages that are created automatically by your automation rule, and that's not going to help people discover the information they need to be successful. Every page created in a Confluence space has to have a unique name, and that's where we can use smart values here in the page title to give the page a unique and informative name. Now we can write some words just in normal language, and then we can use the double mustache syntax to define our smart value. Don't be intimidated by the double mustaches. This is just a way to say, hey, would you add a date that is for the next Monday, whatever the date for Monday is? And every time the automation rule runs, it will always pick out the date for the next Monday, so that date will always be unique. Finally, it's often a good idea to use a template, especially in automation rules that are creating things on a time-based cycle. These pages are all going to be similar, they should be formatted in a similar way, and this is why we're going to use a template that is in the same space as the automation rule. That way, everyone on the team understands where this template is coming from and why the new page looks the way it does. So now the automation rule creates a new page, let's add another action to email everyone on the team, letting them know they can start collaborating. Here I can pick the user or groups of users who should receive the email, and I can use a combination of text and smart values to give people context and even a clickable link so they can get right into the page and get working. One thing you should keep in mind is that while it's easy to send notifications and emails from your automation rules, you should focus on the content of those so they don't just become spam. Keep the content clear so everyone can quickly understand what the email is about. Keep that content short. You don't want them wasting time in their inbox. You want them to get into the content in Confluence. Make sure the messaging is engaging so they don't just sweep it off with some kind of email inbox filter, and also make it easy for the team by adding context and clickable links so they can get off to collaboration land. When you've got it all together, you can save your automation rule with a few important pieces of information. One of those is the name of the automation rule. You could name it anything you like, but the best thing to do is give it a name that describes what the automation rule does. So in this case, it might be Create Weekly Marcom Alignment Page. Also, it's generally best practice to allow all admins to be able to modify the automation rule. There are specific cases where you might want to keep it private or limit it to a certain subset of admins, but most generally, make sure everyone has the ability to edit it as long as they're an administrator. Once you've published an automation, let your team know. Let them know what the automation is going to do, show them an example of the page or whatever it is that it does, so that nobody's going to be surprised when it just happens. Also, you can turn off automation rules at any time without having to delete them, so you can continuously improve them to make sure they're meeting your team's needs. So that covers the basics of automation in Confluence, but there are some cool, more advanced things that we can do to kind of change up the formula or do a little bit more with the automation rules we're creating. As I've mentioned before, one of the powerful things you can do with automation in Confluence is actually trigger things to happen in your other apps like Slack or Microsoft Teams or Twilio. Here's an example of a notification being sent to Slack about that new meeting page that's being created by our example automation. And if there isn't an integration already for an app that you're using, check out the webhook functionality with automation because you might be able to make your own integration. Pretty cool. One really powerful tool is the ability to have manually triggered automation rules. So instead of triggering on a time or an action, someone using, say, a Confluence page could manually start an automated workflow. This can be a real time saver if you have a bunch of complex tasks that people typically perform manually. Those could be done with a click of a button. So this would be great, for example, if you want to send a notification to Slack requesting that teammates proofread the page that you just published. Having this as a manually triggered automation allows people to decide when they're actually ready for that proofreading rather than having it just be triggered on as soon as you publish the page. Ooh, nervous. Are you ready to get really crazy with it? You can also use web requests to send a whole bunch of different information over to a third-party app that you're using in your process, and even receive information back that is used in the rest of your automation rule. You can do all sorts of fun stuff with web requests because you can essentially use the public API for any tool to send information to that tool and back to Confluence, including sending things directly to the Confluence API itself. Now, there are many types of automations that should automatically be triggered, like this one, for example. Here, we are automatically archiving all pages that haven't been updated in 6 months or more. This is an automation that doesn't need to be manually triggered, and you can see how it's just working in the background to help the team keep that particular space cleaned. Another tool you might be using right next to Confluence is Atlassian's Jira, and you can actually create Jira issues right from a Confluence automation. For each automation rule you create, you have to connect it to a certain Jira site, since you might actually be using multiple. Here you can select the project and issue type for the new issue, as well as the fields you want updated. And in the summary and description, you can use smart values to dynamically add information from the rest of your automation rule. So it'll be a very, very nice Jira issue that is made. If you're not convinced yet that your team can use automation to do things in the very best way possible, here are a couple of extra things to keep in mind. There is an entire library full of automation templates that is constantly being added to by the Atlassian team. You can create global automations that are accessible across the entire site, which is great if you create an automation that's so good that other teams want to use it as well. You can check out the audit log on any automation rule to see what might be going right or wrong and troubleshoot any issues. You can add labels to your automation to help better organize them, help people understand what they are for. We actually have an entire video all about labeling best practices, so check that out. And also, you can customize the rule actor. That is, when the rule runs to create a page or send an email or whatever it's doing, who is the user in Confluence that is shown to be the one doing that thing? The rule actor can either be an individual user or a group of users. So there you have it. Whether you are new to Confluence or a seasoned user, automation in Confluence helps make your workflows more efficient and less manual. At K15T, we continue to find tasks and processes that we've been doing manually in the past that now we can do without even thinking using Confluence automation. And the Confluence team continues to improve this feature, giving us even more components to work with. So every day it seems there's more we can automate so we can focus on the things that we really enjoy doing. And of course, this is just automation in Confluence. There is so much more you can do. And at K15T, we're always looking to automate the boring things so we can focus on exploring those. So hit that subscribe and bell icon, share this video with a coworker who's sick of doing something manually, and join us for another video as we continue to explore how to use Confluence to share what you do best.